All right, in Deuteronomy 32, I'd like to read the first three verses. It says, "Give ear, O ye heavens, and I will speak, and hear, O earth, the words of my mouth. My doctrines shall drop as the rain, my speech shall distill as the dew, as the small rain upon the tender herb, and as the showers upon the grass. Because I publish the name of the Lord, ascribe ye the greatness of our God." I'd like to preach this morning on the topic of the gentle gospel. The gentle gospel. I think a lot of times we are guilty, and especially me, of making the gospel a harsh thing. That we preach on sin. We preach on how reprehensible it is. We preach on the severity of sin. And sometimes I think by perhaps our own force of will, we try to pound the gospel down to people's throats and get them, make them, force them into believing. But that's not the gospel of Jesus Christ. Yes, sin is ugly. Sin is reprehensible. Sin is an abomination. It's all those things, and we're all sinners. But understand, the gospel is a message of love. Ever since I was a child, I heard that the word gospel meant good news. Good news. Now, as I said, there is a time or place to be forceful with the gospel. There is a time and place to be speak on the horrendousness of sin, but never let us forget what the gospel is. It is a message of love. Moses said that his doctrine shall drop as rain, his speech shall distill as dew, as small rain upon the tender herb and as showers upon the grass. I believe that's a description. He calls it his doctrine. Well, our gospel should be our doctrine. What we teach, what we preach. Now, Moses was by no means a stranger of being easy on sin. Matter of fact, he was known as the lawgiver. He had given them the law that he brought down from Mount Sinai. He was very stern. He wasn't wishy-washy on sin. He wasn't permissive on sin. But he wanted them to know, and he's coming down to the end of his life. He's coming down to the point where he's no longer going to lead them. And as they were to go on and they would follow after Joshua, he wanted them to know that the God that gave them these laws was the God that led them through the wilderness, that provided for them, that saved them from harsh encounters, from battles, from famine, from thirst, from themselves. He compared his gospel to small rain on the tender herb. So what is the purpose of the gospel? What is the purpose of that small rain? It is to grow things up. It is to cause things to grow. Now, a harsh rain will beat things down. We'll tear the herbs from the vines. We'll destroy or erode the soil. But he said this is a small rain upon the tender herbs, the herbs that are not strong enough to take it. The reason why the small rain comes and why it's so refreshing and so life-giving is it's given that they should live. Anyone that knows anything about plants or any life, as a matter of fact, but since we're talking about herbs, anything about plants, you know they have to have water in order to live. Now, certain plants are different, but Sister Pie had these flowers that were hanging in a basket on the porch. And these were very, if you didn't water those things every day, you would see it almost immediately. You'd go out the next day and they would already start to dry up. The gospel is given to us that we might live. It was not given to us that we might suffer or be condemned. As a matter of fact, let's look at what many have called the gospel in a nutshell, John 3:16. People say, why are you always quoting John 3:16? Because it's so good. You know, if I have a favorite song, I sing it all the time. If I have a favorite type of meal or a favorite food, I eat that as much as possible. So why do I go to John 3:16 so many times? Why do I quote John 3:16 so much? Because it's so good. I love the thought that God gives us here. It says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And we quote that and we hear that. As a matter of fact, I just a week or so ago, I got a tie that has that verse on it. There used to be a guy that would go to football games and go to sporting events, and he'd wear this rainbow-colored wig, and he'd hold up the sign that said John 3:16. He wanted people to look up that verse, that they would know how to be saved. But not so famous as the next verse. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. He that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son. And this is the condemnation, that life has come into the light that has come into the world. And men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds are evil. That whole little section that we just read starts out, for God so loved. That's the message of the gospel. And like I said, there is a time to preach one of the great sermons of yesteryear was sinners in the hands of an angry God. But the message of the gospel starts out with the love of God. The God is not about our sin, it's about God's love. We already had our sin. We're already living in sin. Jesus said we were condemned already. The gospel does not condemn our sin. We were condemned already. The gospel tells us that God so loved us. So loved us that he gave his most precious possession, his only begotten Son. What manner of love is that? That he would give his only begotten Son. A few years ago, I was preaching a message on the prodigal son. You're all familiar with the prodigal son, the story. If not, I'll quickly refresh you. There was a father that had two sons. One was hardworking, and The other was not so much. The younger son wanted to go out and have his inheritance now and didn't want to wait for his dad to pass away. So give me my inheritance now. And he went around and he spent up all the inheritance on riotous living. And he was his friends had forsaken him at that point. He was living with the hogs. He had got a job feeding the pigs. And if you're a Jew, you understand that that is the lowest of the low that you would be, have anything to do with pigs. And he's sitting there and he's looking at that slop and he's actually eating some of that slop. And it occurs to him, it says he came to himself. How many of my father's servants are treated better than this? And he decided, I will arise and go back to my father's house. And he was thinking about what he was thinking of the right words. You don't need the right words to go to your father. You just need to go to your father. But it wasn't that the son was immediately had become a good person. It wasn't that there was anything good in the son that caused him to go to his father's house. It was the love of the father. He knew that the father would take care of him. He knew that the father was good to his servants. He said, I'm no longer worthy to be a son, but I would love at least to be a servant. We love to be God's son. We love to be God's child. But give us a servant's heart as well. It was the father's love that brought him to the father. The message of the gospel is a message of God's love. That's why people will come to the Father. That's why people will respond to the gospel. Perfect love cast without fear. We need to remind people of the Father's love as we preach our gospel. The gospel is there for our salvation. Matter of fact, it is the only means of salvation. I was listening to R.C. Sproul speak on this subject. And he was talking about John 3:16. And when I was listening to it, and up until just a few seconds ago, I didn't know I was going to share this with you. But he was talking about John 3:16. And he said, God didn't say that he gave Buddha, that he gave Allah or Muhammad. God didn't say that he gave anyone else. He said his only begotten son. That is the only means of salvation. Many say, well, it doesn't matter how you get there. Just get there. No, the only way. Jesus said, no one cometh unto the Father but by me. And people say, well, isn't that harsh that you're condemning all these people to hell? All these people that are not Christians, or that you're condemning them to hell? No. The scripture says, the gospel says there in John 3 that they're already condemned. They love darkness rather than light. They love their own way. They love their own means rather than light, which is Jesus Christ. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. It's not a message of condemnation because we're already condemned. The gospel is a message of salvation. It gives us the means by which we can be saved. Moses compared it as small rain upon gentle herbs. That means we need to think about the penetration of the gospel. The gospel must be absorbed. If the rain just bounces off those herbs, it does them no good. You can preach the gospel. You can share the gospel and it never get through. But when the Holy Spirit causes the gospel to be absorbed, it is life-changing. I talked about those flowers that Brenda had. They would perk right up once you gave them some water. It makes all the difference in the world. The preaching of the gospel is of none effect unless the Holy Spirit causes that gospel to be absorbed. It needs to be absorbed into the earth. That's the way that it gets nutrient. Now, how can you absorb the gospel? If you're here today and you're lost, how can you absorb the gospel? By faith. By grace are we saved through faith. And that not of ourselves, it is the gift of God. Not of works, lest any man should boast. You take the gospel in by faith. You believe the gospel. You trust in the gospel by faith. It has to be absorbed into the earth. It has to be absorbed into the soil. You ever share the gospel with anyone and they don't get saved? You ever do that? That doesn't happen, does it? As a matter of fact, it's more likely that they will not get saved when you share the gospel with them than it is that they will. I mean, it's a rare instance when you come up to somebody, you share the gospel, and they instantly just accept it. The same way you don't throw a seed, you know, the gospel is compared to a seed in the New Testament. You don't just throw a seed in the ground and you don't see it just spring right up. Those that sprung up the quickest were thrown among the rocks. And they had no root. Not only do we spread it upon the herb, but we saturate the soil as well, don't we? We make that soil different. We feed that soil and we put the nutritious water, the nutritious rain into that soil as well, that it will be absorbed over time. Jesus compares the spreading of the gospel and he talks about all the different soils that there were. Some fell among the thorns and some fell among the rocky soil and he said, but some of it fell on good ground. It was the same seed. It was the same gospel. There wasn't a problem with the seed. There wasn't a problem with the message. But the soil must be saturated. We need to soak our area with the gospel. People may not get saved right away. But there will be people that you may meet down the roads. You know, you shared the gospel with me years ago. And I'm a Christian now. It has to be absorbed into the soil and it has to be absorbed into the root. That small rain is a good thing. But I think that rain needs to be a consistent rain as well. Not just a splash here and a splash there. But you get a good gentle rain that lasts for a while. That's when you really start to see things grow. People may share the gospel here and there, but when you, it's a part of your daily life. When you go around bearing precious seed everywhere you go, spreading that water, spreading that gospel everywhere you go, then you'll start to see a difference. Then you'll start to see fruit. 2 Timothy 4:2. You're familiar with this verse, I'm sure. Preach the word, be instant in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. Don't just splash it here and there. Don't just wait. Oh, I'm waiting for the Holy Spirit to lead me to someone. Yeah, the Holy Spirit may lead you to someone, but be spreading that gospel while you're waiting. That gentle, small rain of the gospel. Spread it everywhere you go. How refreshing is a gentle mist? Don't you feel much better when you get that gentle mist? I know when you go to the amusement parks nowadays, on hot days, they have these little stations where it spreads out a mist. People need that refreshment. We live in a hard, dark, barren world. Everything is savage and brusque and everything. In order for the gospel to penetrate, we need to be consistent. We need to be constant in the preaching. What about the prospect of the gospel? The reason why we sow, the reason why we water is because we want to see fruit, do we not? In Romans chapter 11, verse 14. If by any means I provoke to emulation them which are my flesh, and might save some of them. Paul says the reason I do what I do is that some might be saved. You know, we talk about rewards in heaven. Oh, you'll be rewarded in heaven if you preach the gospel, if you spread the gospel, if you witness. And I would give up every reward in heaven. I wouldn't give up heaven, but I'd give up every reward in heaven if people would be saved. That would be enough reward for me. That would be enough. If I got to heaven and I saw this person and that person and another person and knew that I had had a part in sharing the gospel with them, what greater reward is that? That's better than a mansion. That's better than streets. That's better than anything. Oh, that I might see people saved. Now, Paul's talking about his kinsmen. He's talking about the other Jews. And we do want to see those that are closest to us be saved. He said elsewhere in Romans that if he would be accursed to see these people saved. But the reason we do what we do is that others will be saved. If you're just looking for a reward down the road somewhere, I don't think it's enough. I don't think it's enough. The true joy as a Christian, the true reward is when you see others saved, others snatched from hell. That is the prospect of the gospel. What about the power of the gospel? Going back to our text that we read, Deuteronomy 32, and in verse 3, because I will publish the name of the Lord, ascribe ye the greatness of our God. He said, my doctrine is like a small rain upon an herb. It's like a tender herb. It's like a gentle rain. It's like the mist of the dew. So gentle is that gospel, but so powerful, because the power of God is behind it. The power of God is behind that gentle gospel. The still small voice is the power of God. He said, I will share the gospel because of the greatness of our God. God is great. God is able to take that small mist and make something grow from it. Romans chapter 1, verse 16. Since I'm preaching on verses that I have printed on my ties, I've got another tie, Romans 1, 16. I might just lay my ties out here someday and just preach from my ties. You can preach from your tithes, just don't preach on tithing, right? Is that? Ooh, it's quiet in here after that. Romans 1. Verse 16. He said, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. What a powerful message we have. If we just share the gospel, we don't have to pound it down people's throats. We don't have to point our fingers at people and shout. Just preach. Just share the gospel in love and in kindness. And then I think when I read this verse about the prosperity of the gospel, what do herbs do when you grow? They grow more herbs. Kind begets kind. The seed falls. And more grow. Not only is the gospel given to us for our salvation, it is given to us that we might share and we might spread and others might be saved. Jesus talking about his own death in John chapter 12, verse 24. Verily I say unto you, except a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, it bringeth forth much fruit. We need to die to ourselves. Put away our own selfishness. Get out of our comfort zone. And share the gospel. That we can bear much fruit. That is our purpose as Christians. That is our mission. That is our commission. Is to share the gospel, preach the gospel to every creature. Now what happens with the preaching of the gospel? People are saved. Matthew 13:23. Now we've already referred to the parable of the soils. In Matthew 13 and verse 23. It says, but he that received the seed into the good ground is he that heareth the word and understandeth it, which also beareth fruit and bringeth forth some hundredfold and some 60 and some 30. The gospel was given, well, it was given throughout the Old Testament. Not many understood it. It was given throughout the Old Testament. It was given to Adam and Eve in the garden. It goes back, all the way back to the first sin. But as people started getting a real concept around the time of Jesus, as he was showing him these things, showing people these things, about the gospel, how he later came back and explained all these things to his disciples. It still has the power to save. It still has the power to change lives. It still has the power to change destinies. It still has the power to take one who is on the road to hell and snatch them and turn them and put them on the path to heaven. The gospel is one of love, but it is a gospel that needs to be heard. It needs to be heeded. If you're here today and you've never accepted the gospel of Jesus Christ, Christ said you are condemned already. It doesn't I'm saying this with all the love that I can. It does not have to be that way. Would you not take this gospel, believe it, trust in it? You will never regret it. Why don't you all stand?